So in this video, I'll cover our solar PV and Tesla Powerwall 2 performance for February 2022 here in the UK, along with our costs for heating and powering our home and running our two EVs. So stay tuned. Hi, John here and welcome. It's another monthly update on our energy consumption and offset from our battery and solar panels. If you watched last month's update, I stated that I'd be waiting until I got my energy bills, which appears around the sort of 5th, 6th of each month before making the next video. At the end of this video, I will share our bills for our gas and electric, so you'll be able to see how much we spent, and show you the day by day as well if you're interested. As ever, a complete item by item list of our setup is down below underneath in the description, as well as the graphic on screen that you're currently looking at. We had a temporary minor glitch with the Tesla app due to an update in the middle of the month. With that update, we lost the impact percentage figures for a few data points. But thankfully, Tesla realised this and released an update a few days later and fixed the problem, so I can include those figures in my details I'm going to share with you. We've just had our FIT payment as well, covering the 1st of December through to the 1st of March 2022. 499 units generated during that time. Plus 50% of that comes as a deemed export, which worked out at £289.45. That's based on 56.03 pence per kilowatt hour. From April 2022, that rate increases to 60.23 pence per kilowatt hour. Oh yeah, a couple of other little things worth telling you about. Octopus Energy ran a great incentive called the Winter Workout, which was a three-month incentive with the aim of reducing gas usage. Around 220,000 of their customers took part, which is phenomenal. And you had to choose a savings target in percentage terms over those 3 months. I chose a 20% reduction in gas usage and perhaps should have been a little bit more considerate about it. But I figured with all the energy savings that I'd done in the summer, it'll be about right. It really was a wet finger approach, you know, stick it in the air on my part, to be fair. And I figured that with the draft reduction measures, the insulation improvements and reducing the boiler temperature to its lowest setting and reducing the thermostat to 19 degrees, I thought, 20% would be achievable. In the end, we did actually save. We saved 5% so over the 3 months. So, you know, I'll take that. A saving is a saving after all. So let's move on to our monthly stats, shall we? So this chart looks at our solar generation figures. So for February 2022, our two south-southwest facing 6.34 arrays produced a total of 362 units. And we just eased past January's total in the last few final days of the month. Actually, it was a bit tight up until then. Over 3 days, we generated just shy of 100 units over those last 3 days. And if that sunshine hadn't have happened right at the end of the month, then it would have been a very bleak February for us. Just look at that perfect curve from morning through to sunset on that particular day. So yeah, there were some cracking days towards the end of the month. Our average daily solar generation was 13 units for the month compared to 11 in January. I'm not sure we'll see the same bumper figures as we saw in 2020 for March, April and May, but we'll have to wait and see. It hasn't looked so good so far this month with generation into the early part of March. So we'll see how that pans out over the rest of the month. Our total generation figure for period divided by the size of our solar array is 362 units divided by 6.4. works out at 57 units, just for those that are still running that comparison. So how did you all get on? Did you have a good month as well? As ever, if you could drop your totals and comments down below under the video, that would be much appreciated. Let's have a look at the split between the two arrays. We had our 4 kilowatt array produced 226 units. And our newer 2.34 array produced 136 units. and no discernible drop in performance across either array, looking at those numbers and their percentage contributions to the overall. We're lucky where we're situated. We have no shading whatsoever at any part of the day. So if it's sunny, we can generate, which is good to see. Scrolling on down to the next chart, this looks at our percentage contribution of the Powerwall 2 and solar to our overall self-power for the house. The contributions between the Powerwall and solar meant we were 45% self-powered for the month, a minor increase from January, where we were 44%, as you can see there in the chart. So yeah, just a little bit more yellow, a little bit more sunshine, and a little bit less Powerwall contribution as a result of that, based looking at that from February to January, as it were, comparing like for like. Oh yeah, a couple of people have asked me to revisit my Tesla Powerwall 2 video I uploaded in December 2020, where I looked at sort of 2 years of ownership with the battery. I've started to create a new updated video on that. So this is actually quite timely, I guess, due to the high prices and electricity that we're all being hit with at the moment. So it'll be interesting to see how those figures pan out. But as you can tell, as I've not uploaded it, I haven't finished it yet, but it's in the pipework, as they say. So if you're interested in that video, then do remember to subscribe if you're not already. Hit the notification bell icon so you don't miss it when it drops into the upload queue. Subscribing is free, and by clicking the notifications, it means you'll get to know as soon as it's uploaded. This chart looks at our year-on-year for our PV. So February 2020, where are we, John? 2020, yes. February 2020 was a bump-up month with 384 units, and February 2022 was the second best over the 11 years of data that I've got there. And yeah, I've been manually recording my data in a spreadsheet every single day for 11 years. Just let that sink in for a bit. No automation here. So that's the month by month. This is our Powerwall in and out chart. It looks at the efficiency of our Powerwall, so what we were able to put into the Powerwall versus what we were able to take out. Our round trip efficiency for those ins and outs is 85%, slightly down on our normal 89% running. So 440 units in, 373 units out during the month. And I figure that having our Powerwall outside reduces its efficiency by probably a very small margin, perhaps 1%, maybe even less actually. Looking at other people's round trip efficiencies, ours sort of in line with theirs, so I'm certainly not worrying about it. Let's move along day by day. Let's have a look at the day by day. So yes, lots of blue, lots of red here. So houses in blue, what house used is in blue, and red is the energy that we've pulled from the grid. Regulars will know that we run one of our glass kilns every day during off-peak period, which adds a minimum 6 kWh to our daily house usage. Red column is energy pull from the grid. Daily constants here are, again, at least one kiln running overnight on the cheap rate electricity. Tesla Powerwall 2 would be charging during the same time period. We also heat our hot water during the time period, that same time period, rather than using the gas boiler. So the gas boiler is only for central heating, not for heating the water. We're basically trying to reduce our gas usage. So even though electricity is slightly more expensive, sort of 5.5p compared to 3.76 for gas, really in the scheme of things, it's negligible by the time you've got heat losses in there from gas heating and what have you. There's also been a few car charging events during the month, which you can see from those high peaks. The solar generation shown in yellow does look a bit lost amongst all the blue and red. It visually shows that despite being 46% self-powered, we're still heavily relying on grid power for the month of February. You can see those 3 days at the end of the month, 25th, 26th, 27th, where we produced just short of 100 units of solar generation. hopefully from March onwards we'll see that trend continue and those red columns subside. Export to the grid was low again this month, shown in orange. I do try and keep exports as low as possible. We don't have an export tariff, so there's actually no benefit financially of exporting it. The deemed export tariff I mentioned earlier as part of our FIT payment is calculated at 50% of our generation figure over the period. It's deemed that we use 50% of what we generate and we export the remaining 50%. And as you can see, we clearly don't do that. We get paid either way, which is sort of a guaranteed value, I guess. So, but from an efficiency point of view, it's best if we can utilise as much of the power we have generated on site rather than exporting it. Monthly totals, have a quick look at these. So this shows the four data sources we've just looked at in the day by day as a complete total. House usage shown in blue there is perhaps the key one at 1,334.2 units versus our solar, as you know, of 361. That's a 27% offset, i.e. solar produced 27% of our house's energy needs in February. And the remainder came from the grid. And we're going to look at that figure in a little bit more detail, that 1,027. This is our average daily house usage and our average daily grid usage over the preceding months. In February, we averaged 48 units, and that's the blue line. Our average daily pull from the grid was 37 units, then that's the red line. And you can see that's dropping away now that we've got a little bit more sunshine and longer daylight hours. And what we sent to the grid for the month, we sent 24 units to the grid of excess solar, about one unit a day over the 28 days in February, give or take four spare units. But you get the general gist, not much. We consumed 1,028 units from the grid during February, way down on December and January's totals, as you can see there, but slightly more than February 2020 and February 2021 totals, but not drastically different. This is the eddy, so this heats our hot water, and it heats it from surplus solar as well as that daily boost I spoke about earlier in the early hours of the morning during the cheap peak rates. Shown here is just the solar boost. So the eddy diverted 13 units of solar generation to heat our hot water during the month. Not much surplus available to heat the hot water, so any surplus goes into the power wall first, so that takes priority. So unless there's at least 13 kilowatts of solar generated on a day, if the battery is flat at the start of the day, then we're not going to get any excess solar going into the eddy. So running totals for the eddy is 23 units for the year and 844 in total since installation, bringing total savings to 61.67. Before we get on to the gas and electric bill, is the cars. So the Tesla covered 544 miles during the month, bringing its total to 18,071 miles. No issues or problems. We had two public charging sessions where we added 46.8 units. Charging was free for both of those charges. Home charging on the Tesla added 111.35 units. And then 6% of our total charging at home for the month came from sunshine, with the remainder being 255.69 units coming from the grid. This grid energy would all have been at off-peak on the Octopus Energy Go Faster tariff of 5.5 pence per kilowatt hour. The new little Zoe covered amazing 452 miles in the month, which is really quite surprising as these are all short local trips, 5 miles, 10 miles at a time, sometimes twice a day. And it's amazing how it all tots up over the course of the month. So it now has a total mileage of 25,827. No issues or problems to report with the car, although I have noticed that we've got a brake light out, so I need to sort that out. Cost for the cars in pounds per mile is 0.01 for the Tesla and 0.02 2 for the Zoe. Finally, let's look at the gas and electric bills. Our gas bill covered 29 days. Let's make that a bit bigger so I can see it as well. So gas bill covered 29 days and came to £89.76, which includes VAT and the standing charge. We used an equivalent of 2,210 kilowatt hours for the month, or 198 cubic metres of gas, if you want to work that route. Our electric bill for February covered 28 days and was £74.66 in all, and that's including VAT and the standing charge. Here's the breakdown. As you can see, the lion's share of that, well, 91% in fact, came from off-peak between 12:30 and 5:30 in the morning. The remaining 9% was from peak, which equated to 98.7 units, which cost £14.41. The off-peak costs £50 and threepence. So for the month, adding both bills together, we spent £98.76 for gas, £74.66 for electric, bringing a total of £164.42 to heat and power our four-bedroom detached house for 28 days. That's it. Any questions? Then dive down into the comments below and I'll pick those up. As ever, please comment, like, share. Any or all of those actions really help get this video shown to more people on YouTube, which in turn helps my channel grow. Thanks for watching. I'll see you on the next video. And as I said before, I'll leave you with a day-by-day of my electric bill. Oh, the joy. It clearly shows the days where we ran out of battery towards the end of the day, where we needed to pull from the grid. And as you can see, most of the bars are in the left of the chart, which means we were using off-peak rate electricity. And that's where we want to keep it if we actually need to pull from the grid. So there you go. Enjoy. Take care. Bye.